That's one really little message. The previous talk I really loved. There's one hidden message in his talk, which kind of, you know, I want to put an emphasis on, is that if you have a working life ops game, never ever ship a sequel. Everything you have ideas for the sequel, put in you first, okay? It's just, you know, big tip, you know, it has been true for the last 20 years, never ship a sequel to a successful game. Okay, but the topic here is more about financials. I would love to give you some hints and tips to raise conversion rate in RPPU. But first, a little bit who I am. This is a good one. You know, it's actually skipping the slides, who I am. You can just Google my name. I'm consulting free-to-play companies for 10 years now, doing this partly, but also doing online game design. My clients are worldwide. I consulted Rovio, Supercell, Jagex, you know, many other companies, Cybo, Kilu, you can name it. They usually hire me when things are too late. Listen, my KPIs are shitty. Can you help us leveraging them? That's tough because the leverage is a little bit low, but many of them now come to me when they're early on, when they have the first playable prototype, and I help them along, avoiding all the mistakes my clients did in the past 10 years. So if you want to take part in that learning, here's some of that. If you want to have more, you have to pay me. That's my free-to-play, right? So this is the stuff you get free, and if you get the advanced stuff, you have to pay me. Okay, let's go into the first topic, raising conversion. I love games with high conversion rates, simply because it's easier to market, because you don't need 100 million users, you can make your live just with a million, and because paying users don't leave your game. So high conversion rate is really desirable. The problem is that you all have wrong assumptions in your head what conversion rates are. You have seen these, right? It's, you know, in this from this report, it's from Apps Flyer, but you can actually Google many other reports, and you say, yeah, conversion rates are like 3%. This is wrong. It says average conversion rate. And average is a word you should never ever use to use real KPIs, okay? Average means that all games with zero conversion are counted in here, or with 0.1%, so it means that all the crap you can find on the App Store is counted in here. Believe me, forget this, it's crap. There's some good data out there like this, which basically gives you conversion rates depending on region or country. You can use that to predict if you're entering a high conversion rate territory or low conversion rate territory, but again, these numbers are average, so it's really tough to use these. In order to give you a better view on things, these are some of the favorite data I found, right? Puzzle Dragon says 50% conversion rate in Japan. And you say, yeah, the Japanese are crazy. Yes, they are. Every second Japanese citizen has played Puzzle and Dragons, and every second from these has paid for Puzzle and Dragons. Now you know why they did shitloads of money. Of course, you know, you might claim, okay, that's a Japanese phenomena, but it's not. Gree and Dina, two Japanese giants, claim most of their games have beyond 10%, and some of them are successful overseas. The rest of Asia, and with the rest of Asia, I usually mean South Korea and China, usually have lower conversion rates than the Western markets. It means that if you ship in Central Europe and in the US, you usually have higher conversion rates than in Asia. Casual games have less conversion rates than mid games, and mid-core games have less conversion rates than core games. That's kind of obvious, right? But it means that if you want to design high conversion rate games, you have to go a little bit more core than you used to. And casual games are really hard to convert users, but that's a different problem. Here's the other thing. If you look at the top 10 and you deduct the outliers, like the exceptions, let's say you take the top 10 and you delete Candy Crush. Why do you delete Candy Crush? Candy Crush is a 9-year-old design now. It grew on Facebook. So, you know, put that aside. Put, you know, all the other, like, Game of War, etc. You know, put this aside and take the modern games out of that, like, which has been released in the past 3 or 4 years. Most of these games have conversion rates beyond 7%, some of them beyond 10%. So learn from that, you know. Clash of Clans, you can calculate what the conversion rate is. Do you know this? They release the numbers, right? You can actually see how much revenue they're doing each year for Clash of Clans. Put a really high RPP on top, divide that, you know how many pairs they have, and you can actually, you know, just assume how much conversion rate they have. And believe me, it's really high. For me, the daily conversion rates is really a bad number to follow. So if you have your KPIs running like a stock trader in your company, the daily conversion rate does give you confusing information simply because the paying behavior of users depends so much on the weekday. It's actually worst on Monday. Why is Monday a really bad day for conversion? Well, you know, you go shopping, your fridge is empty, your kids want something to eat, so you go out there and you spend your money in groceries and not, you know, in your game itself. Weekends are really good because people are bored and they might actually pay. The beginning of the month is really cool because that's when salaries are on your account, so that's when conversion rate is highest, and it's actually worst at the end of the month when your pockets are empty. There is a mid-of-the-month phenomena in some countries where the conversion rates suddenly have like this spike, and the reason is because all the social support payments are paid out mid of the month. So it depends on how much money people have, meaning that the daily ups and downs really give you misleading information. So I'm a really big fan on monthly conversion, simply because it nullifies all this fluctuating activity. And that's a good one to actually measure. And in terms of monthly, what the industry is turning to, but not everyone has done so, is that we're actually going to a 28-day month. Because otherwise you get really odd fluctuations, because some months have 30 days, 31 days, February is like really strange, and to get a comparable parameter, 28 days is like the best. So in order to ask about conversion, there are three very simple rules with dire consequences on how you think about games, and I want to walk through all three of them. Players only pay when they're online. This is really easy, right? But what consequence does that have to your game? It means that if you design a game with only 5 lives and it says 0, you have to wait for 2 hours until you can play, that's really bad for conversion. What's really good for conversion is that if someone wants to play your game for 10 hours per day and he can do so, that's a game with great conversion. That's the reason why in the past years, most games basically allow unlimited session length. So the old-style energy systems and the old-style hard system for casual games is basically old-fashioned design. It's no longer modern to use for games today. So there have been compromises like soft energy systems, and some casual games experiment with different things. But this is really bad news if you want to make a Met 3. We just heard about that. If you have 5 hearts and, you know, this is basically your paywall you put in. You know, after you died 5 times, you have to pay to continue or just wait. This is not good. The invention how to do casual games to remove the heart system and to allow to play a Candy Crush type of game for an eternity hasn't been done yet. So maybe someone in here will invent it and get filthy rich. You know, I give you my account number so you can thank me for that. Believe me, you know, many companies out there are trying to find the system to get rid of that paywall because it's hurting conversion. The next one is easy as well, integrate monetization seamlessly. What I mean with that is that many of you, and you know, you're all guilty of that, and most Asian companies are guilty of that, they copy-paste monetization systems from all sorts of games. So, hey, Clash Royale, you know, they're doing fucking lots of money with this chest opening system. You get as a reward your chest, and you know, you need like to wait 6 hours until you get your reward, unless you pay. This is so cool, let's copy it into our strategy game. No. This is like a really bad habit, because the monetization system has to be part of your world, part of your game itself. That's the first rule. But okay, I'm going ahead. We go back to that. Believe me, Clash Royale does not make a lot of money with opening chests. Most of their money is by people buying gold to upgrade cards. So when they saw that and tried to get rid of that chest system, it was too late. You cannot rip it out of that game again. You can see it because their next game, they still have in soft launch, don't have their test system anymore. So don't copy it, please. And that's bad news for many of us, is that only power sells. So if you try to sell hats or bikinis or whatever, bikinis might be an exception though, that's not a good moneymaker. So let's go through these. First thing. When players are only paying when they're online, it means that the session length and the session frequency has to be in the hand of the player. It has to be his decision, not yours. Remember the old Facebook doctrine and also the open mobile doctrine? We designed games years ago where we said every user has to play like 5 times a day for 3 minutes. That's how we designed the games for mobile, because we thought this is how players engage the game. We were all wrong. Players want to engage the game as often and as long as they like. not as often as you like. The problem is they might rush through your content, right? So we have to make games which are not content driven. You have to make games which are system driven. And this is really hard for classic game designers to actually think about, because you have to make basically games which are endless. And here's the reason why Candy Crush has a low conversion rate, right? The heart system, because you know when your hearts are empty, you stop playing, so you don't pay. This is the single important. This is the most important reason why casual games, which copy the heart system, have a conversion rate less than 3%. And it took King, I think, like 4 years to push their conversion rate beyond 4%. So they're now at 4.4, I believe, you know, the last report. So think about that when you design your next game. You have to learn about designing systems and not designing mechanics, and that's a huge step. Many designers have to change their mind and their brain to actually allow to do that. Okay. There were games which already had that two decades ago, and we all forgot about that. The reason why more and more games are turning to game as a service, we heard that term before, right? We hear it like every day, but what does game as a service mean? Where did it come from? I don't know, who remembers the first game as a service game commercially driven which was hugely successful? Which game was that? Anyone? Come on. You're thinking about which iOS game? No, no, no. PC. Ultima Online. Ultima Online, 1998. And they went to GDC and spread all the knowledge how game as a service should work. And they termed the game as a service, the term itself, they coined that. And many other words we're using today, they coined that. And they spread all the experience and no one was listening. And it's fun that clients hire me today to explain to them how game as a service works, and I'm actually explaining them stuff I heard 20 years ago. So it's kind of a knowledge which has been forgotten. Don't forget that. So the more you know about MMORPG design and game as a service, the better you will be in the next 5 years to design games. Big hint, it's free knowledge out there. You just have to find it in the internet. In terms of seamless integration, there are some systems which you might copy and paste and you don't know why. Simply because your competitor has it, you think you have to have it as well. Like the damn Lucky Wheel. There are not many games who actually monetize on Lucky Wheels and everybody's putting them in. The reason is, you know, simply because the competitor has it. They don't monetize really well because they just don't work within your game world. Why should I turn a lucky wheel in a strategy game? It has nothing to do in this game, right? You have to sell this lucky wheel as a different concept which fits your world, and then the players believe it's part of their world and might actually pay for that. The same is with the daily login. If you have a strong daily login bonus, you can actually make an A-B test and you turn it off for 1,000 players. You will see that the retention doesn't change. So daily login is not a retention system. It really doesn't work like that. And we all put daily login in because all the games have it, right? So it has to work. It's not for that. It's actually, yes, you reward players logging in, but they would log in anyway because they're having fun. You know, this reward is basically just a kind of, you know, you give them your, how do you call that, your gratification, your, you know, that thank you for being here. But it means that the economy has to eat that up, all that stuff you give for free out in a login system. And there are far more modern systems like daily login, which you can replace daily login, and they're actually working better than that system. The problem is that we train billions of users out there that daily login is a thing, and they kind of expect that, although it's a bad system, and it doesn't monetize anyway. The currency itself should be a natural part of your game. It means that if your second currency, which you pay for, is just for payers, you divide your community into, you know, free players and payers. And that's really bad, because the free players will never enter the shop because they know they have to spend money there. So what you have to do is that first your shop have to have, you know, items for both currencies for your non-players who, you know, from time to time enter the shop because they have to spend their earned currency there, and for payers who spend their currency. And most importantly, when players see the hard currency and they can buy it for $10 or $20, they have to see ways to earn that currency in the game without paying. You have to do that. I call it fair play rule. Many other companies call it differently. But what you do with that is that when players can earn the currency other people pay for by investing time, you're basically putting time on an equal level than money. And this is the key reason why free-to-play games monetize. So if I play a game for an hour a day, and you know, I'm having really fun with that game. But you know, Jens here is actually investing 8 hours per day in this game, but I want to actually catch up. What can I do? I can actually pay to catch up the 7 hours. This is all what free-to-play is all about. It's saving time. And yes, that means if I start the game new, fresh today, and I start paying, I'm accelerating my progress much faster than someone who plays for 2 years. But that's okay. Because the race in terms of progression is not really a competitive element in the game itself. It doesn't matter if you start today or last year or next year. It doesn't matter in any of these games. And there's even that with that you can grind the prime, the premium currency. The trend now actually goes to triple currency or to multi currencies. And many clients ask me, how many currencies you know can a game handle? And endless. The more currencies you have, the more players will love it. There are games which only exist in currencies. You know, all resource-driven games, which where you build wood, iron, and all these kind of you know economy-driven games. Basically, all their resources are a currency because you know they with that currency they can actually build or buy something. So my record was like 17 currencies. We had clan currencies, dual currency, we had event currencies, we had you know lots of stuff, and players love that the kind of thing. So you know don't worry, you know the more currencies the better. So selling power is where the money is. To sell only vanity is really tough. From the statistics and data I have, and believe me, I have a lot of data since 10 years from all my clients, only 6% of your payers want vanity. So if you take your low conversion rate, and from these users, only 6% actually love to buy you know, items where they look cool. There are exceptions out there, yes, but usually that's the case. Simply because your games are not really MMOs. Vanity only works when another player sees me without seeking me out. So if I walk the street of my game and I see someone like him walking in, this is a really cool leather jacket, by the way, I might want that. This is how vanity works. And it works here in London as well, right? If you're walking around and see some cool sneakers and stuff, you might be asking, you know, is that G-Star, Nike, what is it? Most our games don't work that way, unless you do an MMO. And suddenly you see where MMOs are heading, right? Why does Fortnite monetize so well on vanity? Because the whole game is an MMO with 100 people in one arena, and you see other people looking really cool. That's the reason why they allow, you know, they allow their monetization system just based on vanity. But in order for vanity to monetize, you need a huge reach. If you have a core MMO game with far less players than Fortnite, and believe me, most of us don't have that many players like they have, you won't make a good business. So power is what sells. And that's the reason why most games out there, in terms of PvP, have an asynchronous system. Because selling power in a PvP game is a very difficult design challenge. Not many games pull that off, specifically in a synchronous game. Clash Royale did, but they tiered their whole system into arenas. World of Tanks did, they tiered the whole player base into 10 tiers. You know where I'm going to? If you want to sell power in a PvP game and make a fortune, you have to tier your player base. And suddenly you will have all sorts of other consequences to think about. Does your matchmaker still have enough players on tier level 10 to match players? You might not. So what do you do then? All things, you know, you have to ask yourself. If you have a PvP game where you don't monetize in the core loop, you have a problem monetizing properly if you don't have the large player base, meaning that you have to redesign the game in terms of the meta layer. Or you don't do PvP at all. Big hint, PvP in the West is a niche market. Who agrees with this? No one. You do? You're cheating, right? Okay, here's the big hint. You know, besides Fortnite, PUBG, and all the PvP games, and Clash Royale, you're always thinking about, you know, less than 30% of the mobile player base want PvP. The reason is that the average age of mobile gamers is 35 and older. People who are 35 are not really good at twitchy PvP games. Really, they suck. So they don't play it. So they enjoy PvP, if at all, in asynchronous mode. And asynchronous PvP is monetizing very differently than synchronous PvP. So here you go. If you do a real-time PvP game, you have basically the 13-year-old to 26-year-old in your audience, and they monetize really bad. So you have to, you know, find other ways doing that. If you want to go where the deep pockets are, where all the spenders are, you have to adjust the 35 to 45-year-old gamer. First problem you have, most members in your team could be their sons. So they don't even know how these people play. The second problem is designing for these people is a challenge because, you know, they're intelligent people and, you know, they want deep games. So think about that, and you see that as a trend. If you see the top 50 best monetizing game of last year, 2017, over half of them are hardcore games. So hardcore is here. And the reason is because the 45-year-old does not play kiddie games. And believe me, he hates cute graphics. So think about that a little, you know? Think about your target audience. And that brings me to the next problem. In this room, who paid for a free-to-play game? Please, hands up. Okay, everybody who spent less, okay, let's do it inverse. Who spent more than €1,000 on a single game? Come on. Yeah, which game was that? Okay, and you? Which one? Oh. Thank you for being here. Jesus. You know, I would love to interview you because I have no idea why people play slot games. I would love to do that. You know, some clients come to me with gambling games and I'm like, I can't help you. I would love to understand this pair because, you know, from the games I analyze, you know, that pairs come in various types. And I would love to ask you where you fall basically under is, you know. There are players who want to progress fast, so they want to speed up things, they want to save time, right? Like the next one. The progress faster is kind of the positive push, you know, they buy stuff to progress faster. The save time is someone who doesn't want to wait for things to happen. Two different, you know, the front to back and back to front guy. I only buy the optimum is kind of the optimizer, you know, he only buys the best offer and best deals, like the starter packages or the offers and that, and that's it, you know, he doesn't pay for the normal things. I like to customize is our vanity guy. He is here, but they also exist in strategy games. You know, we call them beautifiers. You know, they want to build the whole city really beautifully, and they buy customization as well. Skipping the grind is great. Every free-to-play game, due to endless systems, has a grind in there, and skipping that or make it easier. You know, he would love to pay for that. Beiki, you're monetizing sloth. You know, he's a lazy guy, and you know. He might pay for that. And giving is fun for me. What that means is that he's enjoying your game so much, he's kind of falling in love with the game and you. So he's this gracious kind of spend, you know, thank you for this great game, here have some money for me. They exist as well. But they also come with different budgets, right? And they kind of overlap with the previous one. In terms of budgets, you know, when I spend €100 in a game, for me that's okay because I love that game. But for someone living in wherever, where the average salaries is actually €80 a month, you know, €100 is a fortune. So for him, spending €3 is a lot. But your game has a global price setup. So how do you make them happy? So here's the thing, when someone spends just €5 in your shop, he has to be as happy as someone spending 100. That's difficult to do. Because for €5, he might not get as much as the guy with 100, you know. The guy with 100 has this rush feeling that, oh my God, you know, he's progressing with light speed through the game, suddenly he beats the boss, you know, with a single click, and all this kind of stuff you're getting when you spend €100. And the guy with the €5, you know, he's kind of has the same rush for like 5 minutes, and then it's gone. Now, he will never spend again. So the trick here is, you know, how do you do that in order to make him as happy as the other one? So what you have to do, and this is the difficult part, is when you design a game, you have to learn what pairs want. And you have to offer something in your shop for every pair motivation at any progression point in the game. So the early pair has a different motivation, what he needs, than the mid-game pair and the end-game pair. And you have to give them basically a good shop mix. If you go to your favorite electronics store and you're kind of a beginner and a gamer or TV nerd or whatever, you know, you can buy this cheap €299 32-inch TV. But believe me, you know, in 3 years' time, you buy the 65-inch LG OLED TV with magic remote kind of stuff, and you know, you basically upgrade there. And you know, they designed their shop to actually be like that. And your shop has to satisfy in the same way. So everybody, independent on budget, is an important customer for you, and he has to find something according to his budget, even if he's in early, mid, and end game. And good luck finding a €1 item, you can design and put into your shop for an endgame player, but he has to be as happy as well. Difficult topic. I could talk like 2 hours just about that alone. So what I usually do is that I list all the items in an Excel sheet and put certain player and payer motivation on the y-axis and just make an X if it actually fulfills that. And that way I can find gaps. So, you know, in here I have like early, mid, and end game. And if I see that I don't have enough end game items, we simply design mechanics and stuff to satisfy the end game payer as well. Otherwise, you have diminishing returns. There's one game you can actually play, or you should play, which has like all the monetization mechanics from Asia rolled into one, and they have like hundreds of items in their shop, which is called Lineage 2. Lineage 2 is an MMORPG. You should play that to level 100. This is like your homework you have to do now. You know, for you can listen to me in the next Kettle Connect only if you're all level 100 in Lineage 2, simply because they have all the monetization systems there, so you can learn really everything, how the agents think about monetization. And the cool thing here is that you can learn nearly all monetization systems for early, mid, and end game players, because you always find something which is cool. In terms of serving budgets, the easiest thing you can do is the starter packs. The starter packs should come in two forms, one for low payers, one for high payers. The best sum here is 5 euro and 30 euro. Believe me, don't do starter packs for 3 euro or for 1 euro. You will throw money out of the window. There have been A-B tests, extensive A-B tests. If you have starter packs for 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 euro, and the thing is that the revenue was highest with the 5 euro package. Because the 2 euro package, people don't feel it's valuable, that there's enough stuff in there. And on the other hand, if there's enough stuff in there, you could have sold the same package for 5 euro. And you know, I will provide you with a link of proof there as well, if you like. But the starter packs, of course, you know, they are costing 5 euro, but in this case of this game, they actually have a value of 30 euro inside. So your game has to eat all this, which is the package, which is difficult. And the $30 package is for the high roller, who basically has a lot more money than most people do. And, you know, for him, 30 euro is as much worth as 5 euro. I mean, let's face it, 5 euro is a Big Mac meal. So this is what they invest. And 30 euro is like if you go, you know, eating a steak and a glass of wine. Yes, that means that most first payers will actually buy both. But that's a really good start, like spending 35 euro in your game. Do that. Oh, and the second thing is, many of these games have a time limit on top, like that left 6 days. So you have like 1 week to decide if you want to buy that starter package. Here's the thing. I have games in my KPI list, which are 5 years and older. And we have run analysis of all the payer behavior, and 50% of all payers usually convert within the first week. That's not the problem. The problem is the payers who convert afterwards. If someone plays your game for 1 year or more and then converts, he's much more likely to turn into a whale than the one who converts first. So late converters are actually worth a lot of money, meaning that they would love to buy the starter packs. Otherwise, it's unfair, right? So don't limit these. You might actually limit that, and afterwards you say, ha ha ha, you know, you can still buy them. But just big hint, right? Late converters are worth a lot of money. So the other way to increase conversion rate is actually by events. And there are two types of events. I call them retention events, and I call them monetization events. Retention events basically are events which force you to engage in all the systems your game has. Play 10 PvP methods, kill this boss 10 times, go into the scenario 5 times, you know, do whatever your game has to offer. And for every of that, you get points, and with this point, you get your daily reward. If you do that for 7 days, you get the ultimate reward everybody wants. So these events drive retention up, because everybody wants these rewards, and everybody kind of plays your game suddenly very intensively. And they monetize indirectly, because some people who don't have the time will actually pay to accelerate the game experience to reach these goals. Okay, so this is how they actually do that. And retention events usually raise conversion by like 0.5% to 1%. The next step is actually monetizing events. Monetizing events are events which are designed around monetization. So you introduce their own event currency. And during the course of the event, you can earn that currency. And with that currency, you can actually go into the shop and buy stuff. The game is balanced in a way that your average player, which you, and that data you have, if he plays every day, you can measure how much currency, event currency he can earn, that if he would do so, he can only afford the top item. All the rest of the items he cannot afford. So in here, the trick is that you sell the currency in your shop. So instead of him grinding every day for the currency, he simply goes to the shop, spends 20 euro, buys the currency, buys the cool items, and he's happy. This is important in various ways. The first is not everybody has the time to grind all the currency. The second one is people might go on vacation or have other stuff to do, but they don't want to miss out the items of your event. Because these events monetize highest during holidays. But if you're not at home, what do you do? So in here, you know, they raise conversion by 1% or more when you allow them to monetize by selling the currency. But be careful. The main purpose of events is to distract players from the daily routine. The daily routine gets boring after a while. By definition, free-to-play games are systematic, are grinders, meaning that at some point people are bored, and events is the best distraction. If you're running too many events, even events get boring and repetitive, meaning, you know, you have a diminishing return problem there as well. So raising RPPU, let's talk about that. The first thing I have to warn you about is what I call whale hunting games. Whale hunting games are games which have a really low conversion rate, but an immense high RPPU. Game of War is one of these games. They have a conversion rate of like 1.2%, but their RPPU is really sky high. You can run these games if you know how, if you have a marketing machine to find these whales. But believe me, it's very difficult in these days to find a marketing machine to identify whales to get them into your game. And your business is really unstable, because if these whales find a better game to play and they go, a large portion of your revenue will go. So it's much better to actually have a game which relies on a high conversion rate but a lower RPPU. The revenue is the same, but your business is much more stable and it will run for an eternity. Have you seen when Machine Zone released the next game and put all the marketing in the game, the Game of War actually dropped out of the charts worldwide completely, like a rock. Bam, it was gone. Meaning that without their marketing machine, the game is worth nothing. And that's a bad game. It is. So for me, I heavily recommend you focus on these games. Games of service, MMORPG-like, whatever genre you go in, which can run for an eternity. And believe me, good games like that run for decades. One of my clients, 80 people, runs a game since 20 years. 20 years games of service, one game. And they feed 80 people, and they had their best year last year with that game. It's called Tibia. It's one of the oldest MMORPGs still running live. So, you know, learn from that and see how fucking old is Candy Crush, how old is Clash of Clans now, how old are many of the other free-to-play games, and they're doing really well. So design your game for an eternity. It's worth it because you can live for a really long time with that. And in terms of RPPU, again, it's really hard to find good data. There's some really good stuff out there. Of course, RPPU varies by gross income of the country itself, right? That's really easy. The more spendable income people have, the higher the RPPU is. This is like average from certain things. But this doesn't tell you RPPU of your genre, right? Genres differ in terms of RPPU. So how do you find that out? And there's a better way like that, which Becky says, the medium, the trend, and separated by performance, which says, you know, the all games is the lowest one. And then you have the 16% upper percent quintile, and then the 84% quintile. So you can actually see how various top performers monetize better than yours. But the better graph, and you have to find that on the internet to really read it, is this. Yes. But look here. Someone really made the work. The RPPU by time of month, by genre. How cool is that? So you can measure, if you do a casual game, you know, when is your RPPU highest, and you can basically launch events at certain points when the RPPU is lowest. I can predict that all of us, specifically here and many other countries, have a conversion rate and an RPPU problem from mid-June to end July. First reason, summer. Sun is out. And believe me, if girls are out there, you know, men don't pay for games because they're not online, right? The second reason is football, soccer. Soccer World Championship. They're watching TV and not playing your game, believe me, meaning that you all will lose revenue unless you actually steer against that. Pushing an event out in your game which actually has soccer as a topic works wonders, believe me. So this actually you can find. The source is Game Analytics. It's really easy to find, and it's an awesome chart because you suddenly see that RPPU is vastly different between the genres, and you can calculate much better your business model. So here's a big, is someone from the company here who did Gardenscapes and Homescapes? Someone here from them? No? Ah, that's a shame. because they're doing several mistakes in the game to monetize. The first mistake is the damned 99-cent package. You know, a dollar, yeah, everybody thinks, oh, a dollar to spend, everybody does that. But believe me, a dollar is not really satisfactory what you get in return. And there are experiments that when you remove that package, you have several advantages. The first advantage is that these are six packages. And if someone wants to buy the first time, he doesn't know the value he gets in return. So, you know, what package do I buy? I don't know, this one, how much worse is that really in the game? What can I afford? Does it really give me the push I need? So he needs help to decide. So the first help is that usually players go for the middle. Where is the middle? There's none. First mistake. So I would redesign the shop to be horizontal with five packets, because then he actually goes into the middle package. And the middle package should not be marked best seller. It should be actually marked most popular. Because best seller is your statement. He doesn't believe you. Most popular is the statement of the users. That's one he believes. You know. No, he's gone. Okay. And this here is not best price. Pardon me? No. Yeah, you're laughing, right? But this is how they ship. It's best value. So shop design can lead RPPU decisions. So when you have the right shop design with an uneven number of packs, people naturally will tend to buy the middle pack. And if that middle pack is $20, it means that the RPPU will automatically go to $20. Believe me, it's just like magic. And if you put that sticker on, it actually increases your sales by 6%. And suddenly you're really happy, you know? And don't, fuck this package, just don't do that. And then they do another, I'm sorry for my word, but I'm in London, I can say fuck, right? Is that okay? Okay. And there are two really good websites. The first guy you should listen to is a guy called Dan Ariely. You know, all his talks are awesome about steering users' decisions. The second thing is from DeltaDNA, the blog, where basically they analyzed paying behavior by a lot of A-B tests. There's a lot of valuable information there. The next thing they do is that they pop up sometimes a 99-cent offer where they sell this pack for 99 cents. It's a 90% off. Here's a big secret. If you sell items, not currency, items, never run sales on items. It will destroy long-term value and revenue of your game. Don't do that. And there's proof all over the internet. The second thing is that if you run sales on these packs, don't devalue that pack and sell it for less. Keep it at $9.99, but put more stuff in it. It's the same effect, believe me, but you don't devalue the currency. Because people, at some point, when they're regular payers, will only buy sales. And then, of course, their RPPU is much lower than they could be. Don't run sales that way. So the next trend, which is coming from Asia as well, is what I call baseline and offers. So they have the normal currency shop, like this one, but they expect no one actually buys these. It's just there to fix the value of the packs. And then they have the same pack here with the same currency in here. So for $30, you get $7.50, even in the normal shop. But they put a lot of stuff inside on top. And these packs are weekly rotating. So they expect people to actually buy these and not the normal packs. And that works wonders. And each pack addresses a different payer type. So every payer type knows which pack he actually likes and waits for them to come up and buys these. And usually there are two to buy, meaning that he just spent $60. This game is actually Summoner's War. They have an RPPU of $174. That's really high. But they also have a really high conversion rate. They're doing 700 million a year, and they have 90 million downloads over 5 years, meaning that, you know, roughly they do 20 million downloads a year, and with that they do a fortune. And the reason is high conversion rate, high RPPU. It's a very good game to study in terms of how to do monetization right. But this topic is a lot more complex. I could talk like this. This is actually, just this here is like half a day workshop you can book for me, which is, you know, lots of details there, but I don't want to go into detail here. Yeah, this is it again. Never run sales on items. I just talked about that. Here's a really good link, right? It's actually nicolender.com, psychological pricing strategies. What that guy did is that he listed all psychological pricing strategies of retail. Like if you buy Pringles, you know Pringles chips, right? You know that they are a complete ripoff. And how they run sales on their thing is brilliant. You know, they basically wrap your mind about certain things. And you're always buying the same pack of Pringles, but the price or the content varies, right? No, it doesn't. It's just your pocket which varies, you know, in terms of emptiness. And if you go into all these pricing strategies, it's a wonderful weapon arsenal you can actually put in. And right in the middle, actually, there's a small section where he says that the top economists actually say never run sales on items. So important website here. The only two reasons in a free market to run sales is overstock. You don't have overstock in your game, right? It's all digital stuff you sell. And the second one is competition. You don't have competition selling stuff in your game. So both reasons don't exist to run sales, so don't. The other thing you should avoid is what I call endgame diminishing returns. This is Puzzle and Dragons, one of the most successful games from Japan. They made a fortune here, 1.5 billion, and then it actually drops here, 2017, and 2018 will be even worse. The reason is that the design of Puzzle and Dragons is brilliant, but it has endgame diminishing returns. And to fix that is really tough, specifically at their state of life operations. So when you do a game where you summon creatures and you fight against something like Puzzle & Dragons does, and you have fusion evolution systems and gacha system in there, you should learn why Puzzle & Dragon actually failed in the end. And this is like high-end game theory and game design about endgame systems. And here's another secret, Clash Royale. You know, many of you played that because, oh my God, it's making so much money, has diminishing returns as well. Simply because if you have your decks full and upgraded to a certain level, you know, you're no longer spending money in this game. So the only way to rekindle the spending in this game is to ship expansions, new cards, change the metagame. But that's a really expensive way running your game. And here's another secret. When you run such a game with expansions over years, even the expansions have diminishing returns. Because after you have shipped 1,000 cards, you know, and you ship 10 new ones, the users will just say, nah, I don't need this. So how do you fix this? And the Asians are far ahead of us in this case, you know, how they try to fix stuff. So their design already is there. But, you know, even Supercell has to learn that. And Clash Royale is just too young to hit them with the truth. But, you know, they are listening. They're trying their best. So, as I said, the expansion-based life ops is really expensive, and Hearthstone has the same problem, right? If you have like 1,000 cards in Hearthstone, the next expansion, you know, can kind of, I don't play this anymore, simply for the reason there are just too many cards. And balancing this monster is really, really hard. The lessons how this should work, by the way, someone has invented a system 30 years ago how to fix this. The man is called Richard Garfield. He invented Magic the Gathering, the grandfather of this game. And he asked MIT professors to fix his problem 2 decades ago, and they fixed it. But the lessons he actually told us as well, you know, are gone in the wind simply because there was no internet to save them back then. But you should have listened to this guy because, you know, he fixed it all. But Hearthstone forgot, and meaning that they are forced to release expansions. And you see this, the monetization, their revenue, you know, goes sky high, and then it drops down, you know, off the charts. And then they ship a new expansion, it's up again. And the peaks are going like this. So it's a curve which goes down. And to fix this is not easy. Here's a big hint. A game called Summoner's War actually has fixed it. They don't have diminishing returns, although they have the Puzzle and Dragon system in there, meaning that, you know, play that game and learn it. But here's a little big secret. Usually I play a game for like 2 or 3 months and pay in order to be able to dissect the game and educate you how that game works. It took me 2 years to play this game to understand fully how this works. So it's not an easy game to understand. It's so easy at the beginning, you say, yeah, I know all this. No, you don't. Because they have a triple nested gacha system at the end with a lot of small little details as its secret how it actually works. So this is one game which actually fixed it. That's the reason why so many Asian RPGs try to clone it. There's a frenzy about, you know, copy-pasting this system. But there are many other ways to actually do that, to fix the endgame problem. Yeah. One of my favorite topics, and actually my next talk will be about that in a couple of months, is about loot boxes. Believe me, loot boxes is a really old system. Like 30 years ago, we already had them in games. But somehow now, because some AAA publishers screwed up, everybody's talking about them, how bad they are. No, they're not. They're just used in the wrong way. They're bad. So loot boxes only work when they are the core of your system, the core loop of your system, like Hearthstone. In Hearthstone, you open a pack, This is your cards. This is how you fight in the game itself. In Summoner's War, you open scrolls, you summon your monster box. This is what you fight against. It's at the very core of your game. Then loot boxes work really well, and nobody complains because there are multiple sources of loot boxes. But if you put loot boxes on top of your game, which has an entirely different system, they will backfire completely. So don't do that. This is like the biggest learning in terms of loot boxes I can add here. What doesn't work, that's really simple. You know, one-time expensive permanence. Like, hey, here's a sword, 99 euro. I buy it for 100 euro, and I'm so happy I never need to spend again in the games for 2 years. That's not working. That's really obvious, right? But on the other hand, rentals don't work as well. You remember there was a time when first-person shooters tried out rentals? Here, have this super machine gun for 2 weeks for just 10 euro. And like, not really. People want to own things. They want to pay for it, buy power, and own that, and not rent it. Rentals don't work. Skins, as I said, you know, they don't work for a lot of games, and the game has to have specific rules and systems in place in order that skins actually do considerable revenue. Blocking content, what I mean with this is that, you know, oh, you play here, and then there's suddenly a wall. If you pay 5 euro, you can continue. That's not working, that's obvious. In free-to-play, content has to be free completely. The exploration of that content you can monetize, but the content itself always has to be free. Dynamic pricing per user. Oh, he paid, so we just raise prices for him. You know, he didn't pay, so we just make him the best offers. That doesn't work either. So the offers actually have to be equal in your player base. You're running a service, and service means that everybody should be handled equal. We human beings, meaning that if you screw him up, but not him, you're doing a huge mistake because people talk. And if they talk and find out, they will be unhappy and leave your game and show you the fuck finger, like they showed Zynga. Zynga has lost their player base simply due to this fact. So if you handle all players and pairs alike, you know, you will do much better business and have loyal customers than actually screw them up. Yeah, that's really bad news for services selling this, right? Their services actually, you know, dynamic pricing per user behavior. They're saying that it's a service. I'm not a big fan of these. I'm very sorry. Price increase by time saved. You know, we all played these strategy games where, you know, oh, it takes a minute to build and you can click it and pay and then suddenly it's like instantly built. That kind of works really well if the timer is like less than a couple of hours. But at some point, the building time is so long because these games are endless as well that you upgrade your castle and it says 2 weeks to finish. That's okay for the game itself. Strategy games are for the long-term user. But the instant click to reduce that is suddenly like 150 euro because your price has to scale as well. No one pays for this, right? It's crazy. Here's the big trick. What you do is that the reduction button always has the same really low price, like, you know, 9 diamonds or something, really low. And it reduces the building time by 50%. And it's always the same price, independent of how long the building takes. So let's say 2 weeks. I press it once, 1 week. Press it once, 3.5 days, you know, 1.7 days. So how many times do I have to press to make this under my threshold, like a minute? What users tend to do in this case is that that they adapt a behavior I call machine gun the button. So they go and brrrr until the thing is instantly built. Suddenly they have spent a lot more than they thought they do, but you know, it's their decision to do that. And that's a much fairer practice, and it's actually working much, much better than the really expensive button, unless you just monetize whales. Some companies are really open with numbers, so it's a really good example of live operations service. You know, here's the date. It's a really old game, but you know, they had like the RPPU by monthly cohort like really low, and they increased that. Look at this, and this is all by live operations. So believe in live operations. It can really enhance the monetization, conversion rate, and everything about your game. But live operations does not mean you should only focus on monetization. Live operation means that you give the user what he really likes and wants. And that means expansions, content, and the monetization comes second. Thank you. Now I'm open for questions. Now you can actually show me your picture.
Yeah, thank you for the presentation. It was really insightful. You talk about Fortnite and... But the fact that Vanity is really good for them because of the reach, but also what do you think about like they have kind of a two-tier monetization, like you have the one-off skins and also they have what they call the Battle Pass. It's like you pay for accelerated progression through to get more skins that you can get for if you're a free player. So it's kind of tiring the players into three groups, the free, the battle pass, and the one like kind of for the skins. What do you think of that?
Well, the first thing is that there are a lot of players in Fortnite who don't want skins. They don't care about them. If you have a fair playing field like Fortnite, where you put everything in and you know you have to find everything, monetizing power is really difficult, because if I pay, I'm more powerful by default in the game than you do, you would quit the game. It's pay to win, so you don't do that. So what you try to do is you monetize outside the game, the core loop, and progressing faster is one really good way, which is the battle pass system they have. There are many players who even are too, they don't have the patience to wait, you know, to play 100 times to actually afford certain skins, so they want to buy them directly. And they're offering it for like two or three player types to do that. But Fortnite only works because they have that immense reach. If they would have just a million players, you know, their money would be really tiny. So there are other ways to actually properly monetize PvP games, but they're much more difficult to do. That's the reason why, you know, many opt out of that system. The proof for that is that if you look at League of Legends, which has a similar system, you know, the core loop itself is not monetized. You cannot really do anything, but the progression outside is monetized in that, plus skins. So they have a similar system, basically, is that most other mobile games in the world, and there have been dozens, all failed. And they all failed because they were failing to get the critical mass of users up to support the low conversion rate. And, you know, it took like 10 years until Tencent came and with Arena of Valor, you know, shipped a proper new mobile game which is monetizing well. All others were cancelled or are dead, besides Dota 2, but that has historical reasons because, you know, they're origin from the same source. So if you ask me to monetize a PvP game, a real-time PvP game, you know, the first thing I would ask you is, you know, what I would tell you is that, you know, I give you a warning. Have you ever designed a PvP game before? And if you say no, I would say don't do it. It's high skill game design and the devil's in the details. It's very, very difficult to do that. If you go asynchronous PvP, everything suddenly is so easy. So, you know, what do you choose? The easy path or the really horrible, complicated path? How long did it take Fortnite to be successful? It's a really old game. Many of us forget that. Fortnite did not pop up into existence with Battle Royale. It was a game already 4 years old. So be careful. Oh, and don't do a Battle Royale game. There are so many coming. Really don't. You will fail. If you have one development, cancel it. It's, oh. You know, I tried to count them, and after three digits, I stopped.
Hi, thank you very much for the presentation. I was just wondering about the diminishing returns. What do you think about Steam's prestige? So where when you get to level above 100, you can basically get one prestige point and go back to the beginning.
If you go core, and from the core you even go more hardcore, that's a system players like. But believe me, if someone invests in his account money, he won't reset his account just for prestige. That's a really tough system. And I think it only works for a certain game or game type. It's something I wouldn't touch that way. If you have to reset the account and let the user suffer for it, even if you give him one prestige point, because you failed designing a proper endgame system, then you should rethink your decision about that. Yeah. So I don't like that at all. Yeah. I mean, I paid like €1,000 for a game. I have all my monsters. I can show it to you. You know, look here, all my strength, all my equipment, everything. You know, it's my pride. It's I invested a year of my life into it, and then I should press the reset button, and everything is empty.
Today, we can see more and more games that are hiding the player's balance once he chooses to enter the shop. Do you think that it's a good thing to do or a bad thing to do? I mean, should we show him his balance or should we hide it?
You mean the balance of currency he can actually spend?
Exactly.
I always thought at first it's a bug or that the UI designer was stupid. But in reality, is by hiding it, the user actually might overspend. And if he tries to overspend and he doesn't have it, you know, the shop defaults to the package he has to buy. To be honest, for me, all that clickbait stuff, and that includes the system hiding his balance, is not good for your customer. And because you have a game as a service, you should handle him fair as a customer, because he should stay, if possible, the next 10 years. So if you're handling all your player base like they should stay for the next 10 years, you know, you don't lie to them, you don't screw them, you know, you basically you're really nice to them. So if you screw up as an operator, you give them compensation. If there's something bad happening, you immediately, honestly communicate that to them. And believe me, I had games, we measured the KPIs of each messaging to our community, and the best conversion and RPPU spikes we had were when we posted the worst news ever. Oh, listen, we have to take off the server tomorrow for the full day because we screwed up. Sorry, you cannot play tomorrow. Bam, we had an RPPU spike. Why? Because they love you being honest. They feel part of your family. And if you try to screw them, they will leave your family, and then it will hurt. So game as a service is all about loyal customers and handle them like that.
Thank you.
Hi there. I was just on your point about moving away from sales and not putting... I was wondering how you saw those sort of starter bundles. Do they fall kind of outside of what you would class as a sale?
Yeah. Yeah, they are sort of, because you put more items in it than the value is, and you limit the purchase amount. So more or less, because you call them starter packs, and it's like the first intro to that, it's more or less seen as an offer to get payers in. So payers appreciate that, you know, giving them this cheap once just as a preview how cool that is. And after that, you know, you have the stable economy there. But you're right, they might be counted as a sale, but payers don't see this. The thing is that when they go into regular paying pattern, and that's where we want to have all payers, right? They're spending like 10 euros every week or 5 euros every month, whatever they do, they should have a regular spending pattern. If you then introduce sales, they actually wait for these sales and just buy that. And that's not good. Not good for your economy and not good for your revenue. And that's the reason why sales in the long term are bad. In the beginning, when they just start converting, like the first thing you give them, it's all done. It's like, you know, fitness clubs. You pay them 40 euro a month, but the first month is free. Same system, basically. You know, welcome, test us. If we are too bad, you can leave, no harm done. If you love us, you pay 40 euros a month. And then you forget to go there, and then you forget how to cancel your subscription, and that's how they work, but basically it's a similar thing.
So do you think it's essentially that sort of starter bundle, it's kind of a one-time deal? You can't really use that strategy, say later on introduce another bundle suddenly appears?
You do that sometimes when you introduce new mechanics. Like, let's say you ship a big expansion, there's this Tower of Conquest suddenly, you know, and that hasn't been in the game before, and there are new exclusive stuff to buy for that tower. That's when you can actually introduce your offers for getting payers used to this, you know, because they're critical. I don't know if you want to spend on this money, but with the offer, they actually test it out. And then they like it, and then they can regular spend on this tower. That's when you can actually repeat starter bundle for specific mechanics or separate call loops of your game. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Doit. That was very good.